Pretty soon we'll be using sound. I had all these great intentions for this slide deck here, but I got distracted with this whole Cisco ISS thing and never had time to complete it. So here's my elite agenda as scribbled out at the last moment. We're just going to acknowledge everybody that made this whole show possible, move through them. We're going to have the team members who are running the contests introduce the winners. Maybe the winners will give us a couple of words on what their strategy was, any specific techniques they used to win. We've got some giveaways here. I don't know if you noticed, but the Zone H guys have created a hacker cartoon or comic book, and the second episode came out exclusively at Defcon, and now it's on their website, and we've got about maybe 50 or 60 autographed CDs here. We're going to every once in a while throw out, but I don't want to throw it so hard I'll take out your eyes, so I'm only going to probably throw it kind of in the front here. Okay, if you're willing to give me a verbal disclaimer of liability. Yeah, you go to the side. Okay, we're going to do a distributed attack here. Okay. Do not despair. We also have some limited edition frack magazines that we're going to be throwing out in a minute here. So we're just waiting for them to get put together, and then we'll be tossing the fracks out in between these different sessions. Okay. You got to be on your toes. Okay. So first off, DEFCON 13 would not have been possible without all of the speakers. So let's give a round of applause to the speakers, if you were. We had record participation from speakers from around the world. And this is the first time we've really seriously tried to track all the countries they've come from. And we also spent an enormous amount of time this year reviewing them. The most amount of speeches we've had to reject and the most amount of time we've spent reviewing them. But how many people were here last year? Raise your hand. Okay, how many people that were here last year think the speeches maybe were a little better this year than last year? You say it's about the same? You didn't see any when you were here last year because you were too busy partying. Well, the feedback we've gotten has been pretty positive so far, and I'm constantly trying to, you know, make it a better show. So send us some email. Tell us what speeches you liked, which ones you didn't, things you liked about the show and things you didn't, and we're already planning for next year. I also want to bring Zach up here on stage. He's my director of operations. He makes sure the trains run on time. Without Zach's help, the hotel would never have been a functioning show. While I'm over at Caesar's, he's here wrangling all the cats, herding all the cats, trying to make this all possible. So both of us would like to thank the staff. If you're a staff member at DEFCON 13, please stand up, wave your hands, and let's give them a round of applause. Come on, guys. All the way around. Right on.
And just remember, folks, we stay sober, so you don't have to.
Hey, also this year, we spent a bit of our ill-gotten gains from DEFCONs of the past and invested heavily in our wireless infrastructure this year. Aruba gave us a great deal, a big hefty discount, but it was still pretty expensive for us. But it's also, I think, the first year that we've actually had a really solid wireless network. And so Lockheed, who's been watching over our network since pretty much the dawn of time, is going to come up and give you a quick overview on the awesome power of the new cyber network interweb. So Lockheed, where is Lockheed? There he is. Okay, come on down. Here are the network stats on the screen for those of you who can't hear.
All right, so show of hands, who was actually brave enough to get on the public DEFCON network? Yeah. All right, the rest of you are pussies. All right, so this year we registered over 2,200 users on the wireless network over the last 3.5 days. That accounted for over 3,800 DHCP leases, which compared to last year is up about 1,500 users. So, on top of that, we had over twice as many APs deployed this year as we did last year. Normally we're lucky to scare up 8 or 10, but of course thanks to DT's generosity of opening the vault, we have some stable and consistent hardware this year. Over the last 40 hours, we've seen 215 man-in-the-mill attacks and over 80 DOS attacks. And they were... yes, I expect better next year. We've seen 130 rogue access points, which the Aruba has a very nice interface. You select the rogue access point, and you click disable. We usually do 5 or 10 at a time. It's better that way. We saw 300 wireless bridges, so obviously people were very active on wireless, and we saw 836 attempts at spoofing the AP MAC addresses. They failed. In addition to that, you people are all very, very naughty because you downloaded over 12 gigs of prawn. And that's only since the power outage yesterday morning. Next year, we hope to have even more bandwidth, so I have high expectations of all of you. And who here from the network team is here? Come up. I only have about half the team here because the rest of them ignored Zach's rules and went out and got wasted last night. Oh, Derek, get up here. Derek. And the man in the hat is the man who has done most of the work behind DCTV, so let's have a round of applause for Derek. Right. Derek and his cohorts are down here from Canada. We're in their full-time jobs. I don't know if you get paid or not. They actually run a internet TV and radio station called Rant Radio, so make sure you guys tune into that. So we've been here all week, and we're going to go have a beer now. Thanks.
Actually, before Locke goes, he should tell the story of how he got here in his nice car.
Wait, say it again.
Locke's little story. Some of you may have noticed some subliminal messages. I think Locke should explain that.
The vehicle.
We're very lucky Locke's even here today, so...
All right, so since we actually had to be here last weekend to start setting up, we decided that it was worth risking life and limb to make it happen. So driving up from LA in a fully loaded car with most of Jeff's gear, we decided to come down through the rain towards Nevada into state line. If you're familiar with I-15, you know the hill I'm talking about. Well, California Department of Transportation was very nice to patch some of the tar recently. And if you know what happens when it's been very, very hot, new tar, suddenly torrential rains. Well, being that I had a front-wheel drive car and all the gear was in the back, traction went out the window. The car spun across lanes of traffic twice, hit the sandy median, and laws of physics kicked in. We had a little bit too much momentum to actually stop, at which point we decided to bounce the car twice. We walked away largely uninjured, and I'm proud to say that the Pelican cases protected all the wireless gear. If you've been watching DCTV and watching the update channel, periodically you've been seeing the subliminal messaging. If you've noticed a picture of a green 2002 Saab 9.5, that used to be mine. I may need a ride back to LA later on. Thanks.
Should I just read out loud? Oh, okay, cool. Okay, next up we're going to have Russ Rogers speak a little bit about the DEFCON groups. This is something we launched at DEFCON 2 years ago, and it's taken off at a phenomenal rate, more than we ever expected. And we've been so busy with the show, we've finally gotten around to accepting an official DEFCON groups logo. That's the logo you see in the lower right-hand corner. So that will be the new logo for your group. And I'm going to give Russ a chance to go over a little bit about the DEFCON groups, some stats, and then and we'll move on to the next stage.
All right, we actually started the DC groups three DEFCONs ago, so it's been 2 years. This is the third conference. We started out with six groups that were brave enough to try this out. And today we're sitting at about 94 groups all around the world. 30 of those are international. And when we say international, there's 20 different countries, including Iran, Malaysia, Saudi Arabia, and Brazil. And Uruguay. And if you think about how difficult it is just to be a hacker in those countries, imagine trying to start a DEFCON group. So we really appreciate those folks trying to get together and keep the bond together for DEFCON there. All right, if you're interested in starting one, we're totally open for that. Send an email to dcgroups@defcon.org. We'll get back to you. I would like to shout out and say thanks to Noid for running the mailing list for this thing. He stays very busy. I'd like to thank Michelle Snakebite for answering all the emails that come in over and over with requests for information. Apparently, about half of the people that request information for starting a group have no idea how to read an HTML FAQ file. So she responds to all those as pleasantly as possible after you've received about 200 of them. Also like to shout out to Black Beetle. She's the one that keeps the website updated. And as most of you know, she keeps program for DEFCON running as well. So don't give her too much shit. She's busy as hell and she will rip your head off. All right. As Jeff said, this is the new DCG logo. It's very cool. We were kind of talking about being able to put your city name, country name, or area code underneath the words DEFCON groups. So I'd like to see that go out, maybe a bunch of badges and stuff like that next year. All right, if you have questions, email me at DC Groups. Oh, and if you are the author of this or can social engineer us to believe you are, let us know because there is something in it for you. All right, and we appreciate the work. Yeah, we lost the contact information. No, it wasn't hacked. I dropped my laptop. Yeah, it was hacked. Up across the APs.
Sweet. Okay, so this next slide is basically a summary of all the contests we could find and all the people responsible for running all the contests. And I think, yeah, the Scavenger Hunt, War Drive, LP Con stands for Lock Picking Con, but we didn't have enough space to spell it out. Robot Warz, WiFi Shoot Out, Scavenger Hunt, Beverage Cooling Contest. It was originally the Beer Cooling Contest, but we figured there's some underage people and we wanted them to be able to play. Coffee Warz, Amateur CTF, Slogan Contest, Hacker Jeopardy, CTF, and the Cannonball Run. Each one of these people, if there was any real activity in their contest, they're going to come up here, have a couple of minutes to explain what happened. We're going to build on up to the grand finale, which is the CTF. Put on by Ken Shoto this year. How many people stopped by and watched the CTF, thought it was pretty fucking cool? Yeah. Good job to Ken Shoto. That was a really smooth transition from ghetto to Ken Shoto, so that's pretty hot. Okay, so again, what do you know? Russ, who also happens to be in charge of all the contests, is going to go through them all. But before that begins, we have strategically located six goons in the audience with limited edition FRAC printed books. Very few of them because the printers in Europe, once they realized they were printing a hacking book, refused to print the book. That's a hacker book. Can't print that. Yeah. So that happened about a week before the show. So there's no time to reprint it until they found two guys whose names are listed on the front of the book over at UNLV who just cranked out 200 copies as fast as they could, spiral bound them. So we've been going through them throughout the con. You might have seen some of your friends with them. There's very few left. I think there's only like 20 or 30 left. And those are the ones we're going to be throwing into the audience right about now. Come on. Oh, I've just got a request. If anybody has found a set of keys, can you please turn them into hotel security if you found anything? This poor guy's lost his keys and he's really stressed out and could really use his keys, so help him out. That'd be cool. Yeah. No, they're all safety deposit keys. And so you can, yeah. No. Okay, so I'm going to pass it off to Russ. You're going to take it from here?
Yeah.
Cool. Okay.
All right, we've got some semblance of order here. I'll apologize now if we get off track here. We had about a dozen different contests running this year. A show of hands, who participated in any contest at all? All right, are the contests a good thing? Do you like that?
Yeah.
All right, yeah. All right, so there's about 500 that do and then one guy who hasn't apparently ever tried one at all. If you have ideas for new contests, please shoot me an email, russ@defcon.org. All right, so let's start with the beverage cooling contraption contest, all right? This was the first year for this. It was an unofficial event, but we figured we'd try it out and see how it worked. This is Deviant, and he will explain what it was and how it worked and hand out his cool swag.
Thank you, Russ. Hey, how's everyone? Owned. Who's been seeing these little lighter bottle opener deals hanging around the conference? They were the giveaways for participating in the beer cooling contraption.
Please don't throw those.
Cannot throw them? Well then, come find me because I can't fly home with these bitches. So we only had 4 participants this year. It was really fun though. I was very proud of everybody. And I'd like to just invite all of them, all 4 teams, because everyone did a really great job. So could we have Renderman? Could we have Noid and Lil Freak? Could we have Bacchus and DC702, if any one of them is here? Yeah, come on up, come on up. So overall, the mission in this game was just to take a room temperature beverage, which was out in the Las Vegas heat all day, flush it through a device of your own design and see if it could come out drinkable and cold and perfect. And everyone, oh, thank you. Excellent. That's a private deal. So yeah, everyone did a great job. Overall, we decided DC702's contraption was probably the most efficient because it got the job done without blowing beer cans up and without too much ice in the beverage. Yeah, they had a nice coil that they flushed through a cooling system. They had a pump, a funnel. It was a really, really efficient job. So we have beer buckets for everybody. We have lighters. We have good shit. But in addition to that, I was very impressed with everyone else on different levels. Renderman actually wins the just elegant, efficient, sort of simplistic device. He just took a styrofoam cooler, filled it with isopropyl alcohol, which has a very low freezing point, and dumped in dry ice until it was this soupy negative 40 degree vat.
We actually tested it was negative 62.
And I just thought that was genius in its simplicity. So once we got around beers exploding and and yeah, like danger to our hands, that was terrific though. Bacchus's contraption was a Peltier cooler, which I hoped someone was going to rig up. And even though it wasn't the most efficient, he promises that next year he's going to not only refine it, but use the hot side of the junction to power nacho cheese. So and we thought Noid and Little Freak weren't going to make it, but they did show up with, just in true DEFCON brute force style, a giant tank of liquid nitrogen. Which they just proceeded to pour straight on the can. And security was then involved, so that's always a DEFCON event to me. You guys did a great job. I had a blast. I hope everyone else did too, and I want to see people come back next year and submit some more designs. Yes, free beer is always good.
Renderman's got all those lighters. I won't let him throw at you and frag you all one at a time out of the room. Is that it? Very cool. Thanks, guys.
Thanks.
While I've got a minute and I see Dan Kaminsky standing back there, did you ever get your clothes that you lost at the pool last night? We still have a t-shirt, a bathing suit, and knee pads. Oh, sorry, it was only one knee pad. Oh, it's an elbow pad, right. Ah, yes, he has not picked it up. It is right here, this gentleman. Do you see it, Dan? Raise your hand again. Show him his clothes. Yeah. All right, so you two hook up. I don't want to know how you got them either. All right, before I go into any more, I do want to mention that we had two contests that either had entries and nobody won or had no entries because we scared the hell out of everybody. All right, the first of those is the IP appliance. Who all went through the contest area and saw the little clear ball rolling around trying to kill people? All right, that was Icarus, and it's actually network controlled, and DC480 put that together as a demo for the contest. Apparently it was fairly intimidating because everybody else backed out at the last minute and decided not to come. All right, I do want to thank those guys. They put a lot of effort into making that device to show people how to do it, so hopefully next year it'll go up. The last one is Virus X put together the amateur CTF. And this is for those of us who are not lead enough to play with the guys in the big room, so we've got our own little baby crib in the other room. But I think they may have made it a little bit too difficult for even us, because I don't think anybody hacked it at all. And I never heard back from them, so we may have scared them out of town too. So for the next contest, I want to call Foofus and Mad Hat up for the Coffee Warz. What, did you guys win? No, well, stand up so everyone knows that you, all right. These are the guys that put on the amateur CTF. I mean, hell, they tried, right? Okay. All right, so let's do Coffee Warz. I want to bring up Mad Hat and Foofus, and they can talk about all you caffeinated people out there.
So every year, Coffee Warz is pretty unique, and you're probably all thinking, oh, here comes the part where he tells everyone that Hook won again. And he actually declined this year. He decided that his back-to-back championships were enough glory, and he would let someone else have a chance. So we had 21 entries this year, and I'm not quite sure yet whether that's an all-time high, but we didn't have any disqualifications. Everybody actually followed the directions, which is a wholly new thing. And so we actually tasted all of those coffees. We had 6 judges. Each coffee is judged on 6 criteria, so that's a grand total of 756 votes to tabulate. And by the end of the contest, some of the judges were a little overstimulated. There was some messy writing. They would make strange comments on their forms. And one actually managed to misspell his own name. I don't I don't see Gurney Halleck here right now, but way to go, man. It's we each we make each rating on a scale of 1 to 10, and you might think this is imprecise, but I'd like to point out last year there was an entry, Jamaican Blue Mountain, ostensibly excellent coffee, and it received horrible ratings. And the reason for this was, it turns out, the company that was packaging that coffee was a fraud. This was a coffee scam, and they were allowing inferior beans to be passed off that way. They're now closed down and so forth, but we detected it. So it's not just random. So I tell this story just sort of as a testimony to the collective palate of the judges. Every year, the winner meets with pretty much universal approval, and at this point I'll also mention that for once, Jamaican Blue Mountain is not the winner this year, so it's not as though we were unable to appreciate fine coffee in all its forms. So before we announce the winners, we'd like to thank Defcon, Dark Tangent, Black Beetle, Russ, and the Goons who help us. Also, as always, the Alexis Park staff. The garbage can was great this year. Thank you. And we'd like to send our greetings and best thoughts out to two people who couldn't be with us this year, Alice and also Jay Dyson. This year's winner, there are two categories here. One doesn't get any prize, but we just recognize it. And that's the Bang for the Buck Award, and that recognizes the coffee that gets the highest rating at the lowest price. That's like the bargain, excellent coffee. So there's no prize because we have no way of actually verifying what the price was, and so we're open to exploits there. But we'd like to recognize Just Ken with his Baltimorean blend. Excellent coffee, scored a total of 6.17 at just $6 a pound, so we actually got an over one Bang for the Buck rating, which is excellent. Well done, sir, wherever you are. Now, this year's winning entry was submitted by one of the judges. And before you all shout, oh, conflict of interest, I'll point out first off that the tasting is blind, so nobody knew whose coffee they were tasting. And also that the judge who entered the coffee was the one who gave it the lowest marks, so he's very... it's not an obvious fraud anyway. And it's all the more fun because last year he was the guy who entered the phony Jamaican Blue Mountain and was duped by that and got just creamed. So the only coffee to break the 7.0 barrier at $30 per pound with a score of 6.67, the winner and undisputed champion is the Red Lion Kona, entered by Dr. Van Harl. Are you here, sir? We have some prizes for you. Will you say what he won, Madhead?
All right, so we actually have two prizes for you. One is a T-shirt. Here, hold that up for me. I don't even know what it says. On the front it says DEFCON 13, Coffee Warz 6, or VI. And on the back it says 21 entries, 3.5 gallons of coffee, and VI still wins. Yeah. I don't like Emacs. The other prize we have for you is a 5-port instant gigabit workgroup switch. Because everybody needs more speed.
No.
All right. Cool. Thanks, guys. Okay, so the guy that lost his keys is now offering a $50 reward. He can have my keys. All right, so next, and they've already been told they're limited in time, is the Wi-Fi shootout. So I'd like to bring those guys up. Dave?
Thanks, Russ. Yeah, I've been told I have limited time. Even though I'm from Oklahoma, I'm going to try and talk really, really fast. Thanks, Jeff, the DEFCON staff. Russ, you've always been nice to us, and you sure appreciate it. I'll get the shameless promotion out of the way first and thank Wired Magazine, Trapeze Networks, Jeff Attack, Air Magnet, O'Reilly Books, Pacific Wireless, Netgear, Pasadena Networks, Nettopia, and the always cool Jinx. Yeah. All right, now, on to the cool stuff. The contest this year was a really outrageous adventure. at the top of a mountain with one of those precarious roads, you know, where you look over the side as you go up and you say, ah, bear to the left, at an elevation of about 6,200 feet above sea level. I'll tell you about the other end here in a minute. Two teams in the contest really stood out. From New York City, 4DI, why don't you guys come on up? Yeah. And iFiber, why don't you guys come on up too? Because it's going to take you guys a while. Brian, you did an excellent job. These guys came all the way from New York City. And even though they had equipment malfunctions, they entered in the commercial-only category. And even with their problems, they still did a respectable 10.18 miles. Please, please take your swag. Oh, wait, don't go yet. You also get one of those. Yeah, so that's fun. So thanks, you guys. You were spectacular. The other team that stood out in the contest is iFiber Redwire. Even though there's four guys here, they actually came with their moms and their dads and their girlfriends and their friends, and they had a crew of, what, 15 or something?
Nine.
Well, it looked like 15. They drove here from Cincinnati. There's kind of a long, involved story. They started out in a big Greyhound bus that broke down twice and is now sitting in Denver. They ended up here. They drove to the top of the mountain on the very narrow road with a big U-Haul hauling a big trailer at an incline of about this most of the way, and actually got there. I was quite impressed. Their equipment was very impressive to me. It consisted of a homemade antenna, and this is at both ends, by the way, on the mountain, out in the field. A homemade antenna element mounted on a 12-foot surplus satellite dish that this outrageous setup of brackets and support structure they had welded together themselves and scaffolding. There was even a sling added to support this gentleman's broken foot, which he broke in the line of duty of the contest. yeah. It's getting better, though, right? You're going to pull through. These guys epitomized preparedness in a way that only perhaps Boy Scouts could understand. They brought everything, I think including the kitchen sink, but you left it in Denver with the bus, right? They sent part of their team to a small town in Utah. The mountain in the Vegas area was Mount Potosi, which is about, 22 miles south west of Las Vegas. That's where base camp was. And they said, okay. I said, where are you guys going? Where are you going to go first? Because the judges do distance confirmations. And they said, we're going to Utah. And we said, all right, let's go to Utah. So our guys went to Utah. They also, these guys are also ham radio operators, so it was neat that we could have voice-to-voice communication back and forth with ham radio provided by them. They got to Utah. They towed their trailer up part of a mountainside, and what I hear was extremely rugged terrain. One of the support brackets, you got this 12-foot dish bouncing around, going up, and one of the brackets started to give way, so Ben got out and stood on the trailer and held the dish in place as it's going up the mountain. First, they did two impressive things. I'll mention one of them first, which is they had an amplified setup. Okay, they had these 300 milliwatt clients that they were using mounted at the feed points or the antenna setup that they dialed down to about 30 milliwatts. But they had some inline amplifiers, they were 3-watt, yeah, that they used. And using that setup, they did a 11 meg connection of 125 miles. But wait, there's more. They did. They then took the amplifiers out offline, took them out of the setup, and doing an unamplified shot of 125 miles. For 3 hours. With the same 11 meg transfer. What would you say that your total gain output was?
27 dBi
on each end. 30, I thought that sounded light. 37 dBi on each end. So hence the 125. They did calculations. These guys are serious radio guys, and with their dad they calculated stuff. They felt that like if they could just go through straight air to nothing else, you could do 300 to 500 miles. So rock on. So they not only won those two categories obviously in the contest, but they are also the grand prize winners in the contest. The 125 miles is a new world's record for what they've done unamplified. So gentlemen, you get these, you get all of that. Now, I was going to bring my kitchen timer with me to see how long 7 minutes was, but we also have a little bit of leftover swag that we're going to toss to you guys, so thank you so much. It's been great.
You guys are like fish in the water. You know, you feed them and they pop up the top. Oh. Oh, they did bring their dish in. It's right out front of the main entrance if you want to see it after this. All right. So now we move on to the Robot Warz contest. Who got to see it this year? All right. We doubled our contestants. We had two robots. All right. But it was cool as hell. If you got to see it, it was very, very cool. We had the Irvine Underground compete, and then we also had a team from Florida compete. The way they've laid the points out, actually, where's Kalahar? I'm going to put him on the spot. Where are you? He's passed out, isn't he? All right. The way they had the points was if it was fully automated and controlled by software, then you got triple the points. All right. If it was totally RC, well, then you don't. Okay. The Florida team had a very nice setup, but it wasn't so much software controlled, it was RC controlled. The Irvine Underground group, however, where's Tacitus? Where is he? Is he here? Oh, there he is. That guy writes some incredible robotic software. The aiming system on their robot was totally automated. Right, all they had to do was go through the maze, pick up the balls, take it back, and turn it on. And what happened was it would take these ping pong balls, load them, and then auto-target based on visual images and knock the cans off the wall. Very, very cool. Unfortunately, they still lost. All right, so if I ever get around to it, I've got about 3.5 gigs of digital video of these things, all three rounds, and we're going to stream it from the Defcon site. Really like to see more entrants next time. So at first, let's bring up the IVU guys. I do have something for them. All right, so these two are the guys from Irvine Underground. Originally, this RoboSapien was going to go to the winning team, but since we didn't have anybody in the IP appliance, figured we'd give it to these guys. They worked their butts off. That robot is so cool. If you missed it this year, don't miss it next year. It was really awesome. All right, so big round of applause for these guys. Thanks, man. Oh, hey. Yeah, can you tell us about your robot real quick? You can Here we go.
All right, the robot drove through the maze. It did line following through the maze for the most part. We were able to take over in software and drove by RC if we needed to because there were some seams. We had some weight issues. Drove through the maze, picked up balls using RC because the balls all run to one corner, so we couldn't automate that. It was a last-minute thing, you know, these last-minute things. It goes up a conveyor belt, goes into a hopper, drives back through the maze, stops at a certain location. Hey, stage fright, cool. So balls go down the hopper into a barrel that's controlled by electronically triggered paintball gun. We have a adapter that we custom lathe, thanks to Arclight if he's out there. It brings down the paintball adapter to air compressor hose. Air compressor hose goes to a 1.5-inch PVC barrel. PVC barrel tracks on XY servos with gear motors so it can handle the weight. Looks for three circles in a row, and finds the circles, goes to the firing location, fires. And we were going to get the shot that would have taken us over in the points, and our time ran out. So it was fun. I give major props to our team. They did a great job. They'll be up here soon. And thanks to Queeg and Arclight for who really helped us out too, Echo, everyone else who helped on the team. You all are great people.
Guys, good job. And also a big thank you to Kalahar for building such an incredible arena for the event. It was spectacular. Very, very good job. I want to see more robots next year. Hey, if we double again, we'll have four. All right, so where's Tommy? Let's talk about the cannon raw. The cannonball. Cannon raw. That's nice. Come on up, Tommy Pickles. Oh, wait, hang on. Damn it. Sit down for a second. I forgot the winning team. Where's the winning team? Where's our Florida guys? Come up, please.
Drink.
I don't have a drink. Oh, it gives me water. I'll take it. But the thing is, you don't know what's in here, right?
It's not beer. It's not beer. I won't make it through the... What is that?
I'm going to start talking like Wynn in a minute. All right, these guys, they did a fantastic job. I know there were a lot of different designs out there for bots that were trying to do what these guys did. God. for picking up the ping pong balls. I'm going to let them explain it in a minute. But what we're giving them as a prize.
There's
some water, sir. Oh, thanks. All right. They're actually going to get the Roomba Discovery. This is... the RoboSapien and this are both thanks to UAT, who actually shelled out a shitload of money on this stuff, all right? This is hackable, all right? There are tons of ways to do this. They'll also get the traditional black badges for winning the contest. So I'm going to go ahead and let them explain what's going on, how their robot worked, while I get their black badges. So here you go.
Main thing was it was not a robot, it was a vehicle. The Irvine, they had the AI, we did not. I feel kind of bad about that, but we had a choice about 3 months before. I had trouble with my AI, and I decided that I wanted to have a functional system, so I switched the whole thing over to RC at the last minute, which was a whole lot easier. How it ends up working is, it's pretty basic. We had fans on the back, the fans turned on. These were RC fans for airplanes. They were pretty powerful, and this is why in the third round, which we never thought it would go three rounds, we assumed it would go for one 15-minute session, and that'd be it. But we ended up going three rounds for like whatever, and it just was not meant to get. Actually, this actually worked this weekend for the first time. We actually put it together. I got it put together, and then we shipped it out. So when I got it here, I put it together. So we're even lucky it even worked. the RC fans basically suck in one direction. We had three of them. They sucked in the balls. There was a hopper for them to hold into for a staging area. We reversed the fans, and they pushed them up through a section, which was to a loading mechanism, which went into a tube, which was controlled by a compressor, which we pulled out of this thingamajiggies. If you get a flat, you got to pump up your car tire. A what?
Closer to the microphone.
Oh, yeah. You got to pump up your tire, electronic, you plug into your car, air compressor, it was electronic air compressor. We pulled that out, hooked that up. We had a camping fuel tank, and we had air going. This was totally rigged up. It was all made out of sheet metal and rivets. It was pretty much all handmade. The guy was not able to be here, but he's an Emmy, and he basically rigged up the whole thing and did a great job. I hooked up electronics, and that was pretty much it. Yeah.
Great. Here we go. He's got your black pad. All right, so that was really freaking cool. If you didn't get to see it, honestly, you missed a lot. It was awesome. All right, Tommy, this time for sure, I swear.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to say thank you to DEFCON and the staff for letting us put up for trouble for 4 years now. This was the fourth annual DEFCON Cannonball Run. Last year, as you know, that KTLA came over to the start line and called us a bunch of alcoholics and drunk drivers. I would have had a bigger prize here if I wasn't such an alcoholic. I want to give a shout out and thanks to the five teams who actually placed in the race. We had eight teams show up, one of them being an RV that came down from Northern California. But unfortunately, we only have a certain amount of time where we could put the time clock in the bar because the rest of us get drunk and we lose things. Speaking of, I did lose a video camera that has Cannonball footage in it. You can have the camera. I just want the footage. The teams I want to thank, though, who placed are Team Ninja, Holy Shit, Wife Swappers, which was me, Team Jew, and always Team Sodomy. It was a quick race. Team Sodomy actually was picked as probably the favorite since he won two out of the three races so far and lives in Las Vegas, so he travels out in the morning to drive out to Redondo Beach in California to race back. This year we had three teams that drove out from Las Vegas and back into California, back to Vegas. Anyway, the fastest time was Team Ninja. Team Ninja did place at 3 hours and 59 minutes, and he did get pulled over. Team Sodomy actually came in second place with 4 hours and 1 minute. Holy Shit, who came in from Vegas, and Wife Swappers, my team, actually tied for third, which was funny because I actually stopped for McDonald's. I do have video camera footage of this, had lunch, and then drove out, and we actually caught up to Holy Shit while he was out on the 15. So we tried passing him, and we were probably doing about 125 miles an hour, where we caught probably a half a mile ahead of him, and then all of a sudden he blew by us at probably something like 150, because he passed us like we're standing still. Anyway, Team Ninja isn't here, but I'd like to bring up Team Sodomy to accept the award, since they both live in Las Vegas and probably could see each other tomorrow. So I'll hand it over to Team Sodomy. Thanks.
Hi. I'd like to thank the rest of Team Sodomy who couldn't make it today. They were a little sore. Now, Tommy might have said that we were the favorite, but when we showed up in our rented Cadillac, it wasn't the favorite. There was a lot of talk of, you can't do that, but we did, and we lost. So it goes. But I want to say, though, if it happens again next year, there's been some talk that it might not make it. It's a lot of fun. It's really easy. Whatever car you got, get in it, get MapQuest, and get rolling. And that's it. Thanks to Tommy. Thanks to Defcon for letting us do this.
All right, so next contest is the lockpick contest. How many people competed in that? That was really boring this year. Man, they upgraded all the locks. There wasn't much action there. It was like being married again. Did I say that? All right, so here's Kai Goth. He's the organizer. I'm going to let him talk about it and pull up the winning individual.
Real quick, I just want to thank DT and the rest of the Goon staff and everybody else for letting us do this here. This is our third year. I do want to kind of apologize. Like Russ said, it was a little slow this year. If anybody's watched the first couple years, we had winners cracking these locks in 2 to 6 seconds. In order to get from the first to the second round, normally you had to pick a lock in 12 to 10 seconds or less, which is pretty phenomenal what a lot of these guys are doing. This year I decided, well, you know, I was sick of buying brand new locks every year, so I got a sponsor. So thank you for IVU and lockpicking101.com. If anybody is interested, check out lockpicking101.com for some great info. They hooked us up with some awesome brand new locks that I can rekey every year, very stable. I tried to level the playing field so that all the locks were fair, same pin out all the way across the board. Problem was, apparently, they were keyed a little bit too difficult. I'd like to say, have the three finalists come up, Langley, Gandalf, and Werelock. They're the only three that picked any of the locks. And that's pretty impressive. I think we had about 65 people in the very first round, so we had a lot of people going at this. Langley came in at third place. This is all about, of course, it's DefCon's all bragging rights. I've got some prizes I want to get out to everybody, posters, t-shirts, and stuff. I also want to thank University of Advancing Tech for giving out some prizes for us as well. But while I'm getting your guys' swag, if anybody wants to talk anything, we had Langley come in third place. Give these guys a round of hand. Second and third place battled out for about an hour and a half afterwards to finish, to get through this. And the average times to get to the finals were about 3.5 minutes. And then, of course, the first place winner, I don't know how he did it, but I'll let him talk to you, cracked it in 6.2 seconds in the very final round.
Thanks, Kai. These guys put up, you know, a great lock picking contest every year. This is the third year, I think, right? 3 years, had the opportunity to be here each time. Only time ever making it to the finals. Actually, I think we should give Kai and the guys that set it up another round of applause. Actually, I think it's great that they made it a little bit tougher. I mean, fewer people made it in, but it showed a little bit more skill. I don't know either how I got it in 6 seconds, but I just used a slim line, and it was awesome. But actually, hats off to these guys. I think it was more like 2 or 2.5 hours that these guys, it was like Iron Man competition. And they went on, and finally, Werelock cracked one. So, good job.
In case nobody saw it, again, this is all bragging rights. We had banner made up for this year, and I want to give it to Gandalf for hanging up in his office, hopefully, so his boss is happy with his work here this weekend.
My boss was in third place. He said I was fired.
Grifter unleash some more shirts we found into the audience. So everybody's got the shirts. Unleash the hounds. We just found another box of more stuff.
All right, and Ted actually donated, or Kai got donated a bunch of the LP Con shirts, so they're going to toss those around as well. All right, so let's call up Grifter for the scavenger hunt.
I wanted to start off by saying that up there on the slide is bullshit. If it was just me doing this, it wouldn't get done. So can we get a round of applause for DC 801? I figured I'd share a few of the things that we had go on this year. We made the teams rap battle each other, and the best rap got, you know, the highest amount of points and then slowly declined from there. We had creative use of a slinky, and one team used it to create another item on the list, which was salami nunchucks. So that's what bound their salami together. And the other was DC 702 bent theirs up and picked a lock with it. Every year we ask for a live chicken, and for 4 years we've never gotten one. Say hi to a live chicken.
They want you to have it. What am I going to do with it?
I don't know. Hold on to it for a
minute. They want you to have it. I already had two little baby chicks living in my room last night. It won't be on the list next year. Another one of the items was get DT to slap you hard, which turned out pretty well. We had also argue about whether or not the Bellagio fountains are being powered by mermaids, like very loudly. So during the fountain show, the teams were out there screaming at each other. And I quote, "Fuck that shit, that's a mermaid." We had them duct tape a team member to a tree for a half an hour. Now, this is where we kind of got owned. We put down make a wetsuit out of mouse pads and then jump into the pool. You get 100 bonus points if all of your clothes stay dry. So the teams made a wetsuit out of mouse pads, took off their clothes, set them next to the pool, and then jumped in. And I'd also like to apologize to any speakers and attendee who heard people run screaming from the room, "A dingo ate my baby," or "I'm covered in bees," and then slap themselves running. Another favorite of ours was get belligerent with tourists outside the Paris while wearing a beret. And as soon as the tourists start to pay attention, surrender. And also one of the hunt staff's favorite was we had them make a suit of armor out of aluminum cans. I'm going to start bringing up the teams. The third place team was Team Quiggle, if they're here. Anyone? Team Quiggle? Come on, guys. There they are. Now, we already know who won. These guys know who won because it ended at noon and they were there, battling it out to the bitter end, and I'll wait till I say this, but the second place team is DC 702. So if you guys are here, you'll notice some of their prizes are two big salt licks because that was one of the items and we didn't want it. So I guess each team gets a chicken. And And the winner of the scavenger hunt for this year is Timmy Needs a Liver. So Timmy Needs a Liver. So these guys went nuts. They worked really hard. All of the teams worked really hard. So it was a blast. The hunt staff had fun. We hope these guys had fun. And also, I want to say thank you to these guys because I don't know if you noticed, but the vendor area didn't have Miko in there, like Uncle Ira's giant tables worth of huge. What is that stuff? Crap. Okay, there you go. That's it. And usually he donates a grip of stuff for us, but we got stuff from every single vendor in the vendor area. We don't go out and take sponsors outside of DEF CON. We keep it gangsta. Timmy Needs a Liver, because there weren't tons of prizes and they were getting the black badges, they decided to waive any of the swag stuff, take the black badges, and since they had such a good competition with the other teams, they said give it to them. So round of applause for Timmy Needs a Liver.
We had a lot of fun this year, and I just want to say thank you to a couple of groups and people that helped us out. First off, DC707, DC530, DC503, DC410, NAG9 Security, and then personal people that have given us a lot of hand. Londo, Ecstasy, Maximus, High Wizard, Stitch, Kelvin, and of course the people who run the competition, A, Grifter, and a bunch of other people whose names escape me at this point. And then, of course, I'd like to thank DT for putting on DEF CON every year, because it's a blast. Thank you.
Forgot one thing. On behalf of DC 801, Wynn Schwartzow's daughter is hot.
All right. Nulty Bubble. Where are you, man? Hacker Jeopardy.
Nulltone's also primarily responsible for the forums at DEF CON, so we should give him a little round of applause for making that work.
So this year, Hacker Jeopardy was in its 11th year, and I'm sure most of you have seen it before. And actually, who caught it this year? It was on Friday and Saturday night. All right, not bad. Well, it went pretty well, and there were four rounds as usual, the final round with the winners from the first three rounds. Yes, three people vomited. I think that's a record, so round of applause for that. Is Bobcat in the audience? No. Is anyone else from his team here? All right, that works.
Team Nymphs,
they won. So come on stage. All right, tell them how you won.
We mostly won by drinking more than everyone else. We drank a total of 38 beers in our two rounds. And it was Corona. I'd like to thank the R's, one of which vomited. I'd like to thank Team 303, Dr. Faustus vomited. Well done. I'd like to thank IPv6. No, none of them vomited, but they had to compete in Final Jeopardy after winning their round the same night. So good effort. Also, what was that team name? The drunk guys by the pool deliberately vomited so they could drink more. It turned out to be a bad strategy because they were also Googling for the Final Jeopardy question on a BlackBerry. I grabbed it and threw it in the vomit. It does not work anymore. Fortunately, they have an employee from RIM on their team. I think they can get another one. I'd like to thank G-Mark and Wynn, Nulltone, all the goons who made everything run so smooth, Beer Banshee, and Vinyl Vanna. Thank you all very much.
So everybody on the winning team is going to get the uber cool DEFCON leather jacket.
Right.
Exactly. He's already bitching about it.
I already have two of them.
They'll get the black badges as well as the last edition of Frag. So, there you go.
Thank you.
The official badging, it's the most moving part of the ceremony.
Thank you.
All right, more shirts? Anyone? Anyone? Treat him like a frisbee, I can hit him in the pool. We exist. No, you don't. All right. Normally we have Chris Hurley come up and talk about the war drive. He screwed me and says he has laryngitis and can't talk. So I'm going to try and talk you through these contests, the winners and the prizes. If I say anything stupid, just laugh and act like I meant to say that. It'll be just like Hacker Jeopardy. All right, so the main drive, apparently we had, what, four, five teams that started? He's signing me. Okay, we had three teams start the main drive, and last I heard, none of them had showed back up. If you see them laying in the desert, hanging on with their fingernails to a Yogi, please call for help. All right, and this year we've got some mini games. And my understanding is that they were trying to do this in phases or rounds. Is that correct? All right. So the first one of these rounds was called King of the Hill. You gonna try it? No, you're just here to make sure I translate right. Okay. Okay, all right. So as you went through each round, you got points. You earned points as you beat each challenge. And when you got to the end, all the points came together, right? It was all the points for all the rounds added up for a total, all right? We ended up with two teams on these. Is that? All right, we started out with eight, and from what I heard, two teams dominated and everyone else dropped out because their panties got wadded up. All right, no offense to those of you with the wadded panties. All right, so the first contest was King of the Hill. My understanding of this is they had to hack a wireless network, all right, and then hack the server behind it and maintain control of that server. Is that? Oh, all right, yeah. It's hard to hear him when he's trying to explain this and he can't talk. All right, let's find out. I have all my notes here. So, we had a team that consisted of Beetle, Renderman, Deviant, and Pantera. They did not have a name, so I guess that's something like in the Wi-Fi world of a default SSID, which is what I've started calling them. All right. Now, they ended up winning the King of the Hill contest, and the interesting part of this was that Beetle was actually speaking at DEFCON for 2.5 hours of that. Came in the last 30 minutes and kicked everyone's ass. Okay, so They got 1,000 points for that. The second level was tag. Is that correct? You're guessing, aren't you? I don't know either. All right. We had a team called Preset Kill Limit. Are they here? All right. Bilbo and Hacksaw. And tag was similar to that, right? Okay, yeah. So they had to tag the box that they hacked, basically. Hack a wireless network, hack the server behind it, place a tag file. They got 1,000 points for that. There was Lady and the Tramp. All right, Lady and the Tramp was hack a wireless network. There were two targets behind the wireless network this time. One was very easy, which you got 300 points for, right? And then there was the harder Tramp, or, yeah, Tramp box.
The lady was easy. I'm sorry. Tramp was easy. Lady's hard.
He lied. He's talking. All right? Yeah. Yeah. Preset Kill Limit actually won that again with 1,000 points. They won with 5 minutes to spare. There was actually a path of attack. They had to go through the wireless network, through the tramp to get to the lady. All right? Yeah. I don't know who makes this shit up. I just talk about it. All right? Yeah, Chris does. Chris has kids. All right. The last one was a lockpick crossover, where Kai Goth from Lockpick was supposed to help out on this. The lockpick box was actually hidden at Amaris Suites with an access point hidden inside. The object was to find the wireless access point by honing in on the SSID and then proceed to pick the box. All right? You get 300 points for finding the box and then another 700 for picking it. Renderman's team did find the box but never managed to get into the box. Renderman's.
We bought the pins on the back of it.
Oh. They never actually managed to get into the box.
No.
All right. Yeah, yeah. They took a backdoor vulnerability. They got 300 points for finding it. The other team, as I understand, never found the box or chose not to compete in that one. Right. All right. They instead decided to go for Running Man. Is that correct?
No.
That was something different.
Right.
Okay. So Running Man, we had two UAT.
Preset Kill Limit did Lady and the Tramp,
yes.
While Render's team did the lockpick.
Okay. So they had their choice of those two, right? Okay. So that's how that turned out. Then we had the Running Man, and we actually had two attendees walking around with backpacks with Zorus, with Apache, with Wi-Fi cards in them, and they had to track down the signal and actually find the Running Man, right? All right, Preset Kill Limit also won that for 300 points. Is that correct?
That is correct.
All right. And that leads us to the Last Crusade.
How long did it take you guys to find it?
46 minutes to find the Running Man. Yeah, as I actually had a conversation with him, and he was sitting down to take a break when you guys found him, right? Was he sitting down? He was stopped moving. Okay, so that's more of a resting man. we're going to sick ping on him later. Black Beetle's going to kick the shit out of him, too. All right, so, and then that leads us to the Last Crusade. This was the final round. I do not remember what the Last Crusade was.
Basically, the way it worked, and bear with me on my voice, basically the way it worked was there were five different wireless networks set up with web servers behind them. They had different varying levels of security enabled on the networks, starting off with basically a default SSID, access point out of the box, then going on to MAC address filtering up through web, and finally ending up with WPA. And they had to compromise the boxes in order, and the web server that was behind them would basically give them a clue on what the security mechanisms enabled on the next level were, and they had to do that. So then they got 100 points for the first one, which were basically 100 gimme points. Then they got 200 points for the next two stages each, and then 300 for stage four and 300 for stage five, to total 1,000 points. The interesting thing about this one was that one of the teams was up by 700 points coming into this final round, and they chose to do the running man so that they could get an exactly 1,000-point lead, which would then require the other team to do all five stages in order to tie them. And basically, they took the easy game to guarantee themselves a share of the victory, which was a pretty cool strategy that they used.
All right, so as I understand it, we have prizes for nearly every one of these. Had Renderman's team actually picked the lock on the lockpick con box, we'd have prizes there. And for the war driving contest, since everyone disappeared or vanished.
Well, yeah. But you cheated, so it doesn't count. Yes, you did, Jesus.
Nobody said you had to drive.
Well, nobody.
It had to be real either.
Renderman decides that basically the point, all you had to do was be the first person to collect 1,000 access points. Renderman walks over in the contest area and says, oh shit, Beetle's speaking, I don't have a car, we got no way to do anything. I'm like, all right, it's not my problem. You can walk around and get 1,000 access points pretty quick. So they decided to go ahead and just throw fake AP up and get 1,000 access points in about 25 seconds. So I disqualified his ass.
All right, so for King of the Hill, which went to Renderman's team, okay, we have four Sineo cards. All right, okay, come on up, guys.
Renderman, Beetle, Deviant, and Pantera.
That is correct.
There he is.
All right, so we have four Sineo cards, four War Drive books, and four War Drive coins, correct?
All right. That is correct. Again.
Somebody offer me something good for this afterwards.
Since nobody buys my book anymore, I just give them away. Absolutely. That's how I got in this situation anyway.
All right, that's it. Thanks, guys.
I got you.
All right, for the Lady and the Tramp, can we please get preset kill limit up here?
And you guys just might as well stay up here.
Oh, gotcha. All right, they are getting a signed copy of InfoSec Career Hacking and two USB drives for this piece.
Just go ahead and give them all their stuff.
Give them all their stuff, you guys stay up here. All right, and then for what they won the Running Man as well, so they get two Cyber Exploit CDs and two War Driving coins. All right, and then for the Last Crusade, they also won. They have an access point plus.
They didn't win Last Crusade.
Oh, they did not win Last Crusade. All right, I don't have those notes. Renderman's team got that?
Renderman's team got that.
All right.
Get him back.
Chris, who gets this one? These guys. All right. And then that's great, guys. And if
just leave them up here because they were the overall winners.
And they get all this. Okay, so as the overall winners, they get what?
A shitload of stuff. Well, basically, they get the cool prizes, which are the Defcon leather jacket and the black badges. They also have a laser-sighted cantenna that WarDrivingWorld.com was selling over in the vendor area. That was very cool of them to donate. I don't know if anybody got a chance to see it, but it's very cool. And then a whole bunch of other junk that's in the box. Oh, yeah, and They got a wireless firewall from WatchGuard that's very cool as well. So enjoy, gents. Great job.
All right, CTF. That's it. All right, last one is CTF. So if I can get those guys up here. Is that everyone from Kinshoto? All right, here they come.
Kinshoto to the front. Kinshoto to the front.
So we're going to introduce the people who put on the new Capture the Flag, and then they're going to give us a blow-by-blow and tell us who won. So with that, we're going to pass off a microphone to Kinshoto.
Very arrogant. All right, so this is Kinshoto. First of all, we have to say the Ghetto Hackers, you got to give them mad props. They're really big shoes to fill. They really took CTF to the to a really high level that was really tough for us to match, particularly given only 3 months. So let's give those guys a huge round of applause. All right, so we're going to try to make this short. We've got our own private In-N-Out eating contest that we got to get to, so we should have one of those next year.
Yeah, just don't invite Nick Farr. For those of you who missed it, last year Nick Farr ate a 30-patty In-N-Out burger. And the receipt was like, you know, animal burger. Patty, 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 patty. Well, this year he thought he could best himself, and he was raising money for the Hacker Foundation, so he consumed a 35-patty burger and raised $600 for the Hacker Foundation.
So first of all, we had a qualifying round where we put up a server and had people hack it. There were 130 sign-ups, 80 people showed up to play, and only 15 did well enough where we would even consider having them sit at the table. So the people who were in the room this weekend, they were Uber. You got to give them all mad props, okay? So we started out with a little social engineering. We pretty much seeded the rumor that we were going to be running servers for people, which we did, but we told everybody that it was going to be Mac OS X. We didn't really tell them that, but we made them believe it, and it was the rumor. But actually, it was FreeBSD. We had people who claimed to have OS X 0 days. You can sell them to a couple of people around here. So let's see. But really, we used FreeBSD. The game was similar to what it had been in the past couple of years, but with a bigger focus on reverse engineering and exploit development. Couldn't have a firewall up in this game. It was architected so that you could run an IDS, but nothing active. You could see traffic. You couldn't kill it. So it was a different game. One of the biggest differences was that in addition to having teams compete, we also had individual entrants. So the teams had to attack other people's servers and defend their own server. The individuals just had to attack, and they all had to find the security problems and all the code that we had put there, some of it incredibly evil. So before we announce the winners, we want to thank first and foremost our gophers. They were the people that were running around in the orange shirts. We wouldn't have been able to do this without those guys. Thanks a lot. Stand up, guys, stand up. Those orange shirts smell after 3 days, let me tell you. That's why they're nowhere near us right now. So we also want to thank the Defcon staff, particularly Zach, DT, and everybody else like Major and Agent X who helped us out. And with that, we're gonna post the final results on our webpage tonight, but gonna go over the top three. Number three was the top individual, okay? So we didn't score them separately. They all lumped together. The individuals were competing against the teams. And so this individual, he beat five of the teams all by himself. He was really good at all the little things. So when a team would fuck up, he was there to figure it out and take advantage of it. He was doing a phenomenal job. So third place and first overall for individuals goes to Atlas. Come on up. Atlas is drinking his tab. He's got to be loving that. It's the best diet beverage ever. Yeah, so what Atlas wins is the coveted black badge, DEFCON leather jacket, and a bound issue of the final frack. So Atlas, could you give us a couple words about what your strategy was?
Win and not fuck up anybody else so much that they killed me.
The amazing thing was he had to carry this tab can around the whole time. It got stolen from him by another team, and he still somehow managed to come in first place. He got it back eventually. But congratulations to Atlas, and there's his black badge. So Atlas had 479 points in third place. It was a battle royale between the top two, though. Those teams were apart by only 19 points. They both deserve ridiculous amounts of respect. They worked all through the night coming up with exploits both nights, and that gave them a big advantage over everybody else. They both had their best kung fu action grip, but ultimately what it... the difference maker, one team was a little better on offense, finding stuff and breaking it. The other was a little bit better on defense, keeping their own services up. And this year, after they traded places a lot during the last day, it turns out that offense won the day. So the second place team, who should give a big round of applause to, with... 595 points with School of Root, which means that Shellfish wins Capture the Flag with 614 points. Come on. They're going to get the same prizes as Atlas. They get eight badges, eight books, eight jackets. They also get to take the War Games banner home with them, but they got to cut it down themselves. So let's get a speech.
No speech, just these are the best hackers in the universe. We're all from Santa Barbara, California. UCSB, California rocks. West Coast wins again.
See you next year for Capture the Flag. We'll be doing it again next year. We encourage everybody to sign up. We'll announce to the DEFCON list, but really, congratulations to Shellfish. They did a tremendous fucking job.
All right, that's it for contest. Afterwards.
Tab explosion. Okay, so that concludes the, see this number's all wrong. The EFF Dunk Tank donation. We did the Dunk Tank for the second year running, raising money for the EFF. And this year we added a little component to it. You could also pay a little bit more and get an EFF membership. So for that, we had 41 new EFF members. We had 33 unique individuals dunked, and that number, $3,300, is wrong. I was just told it was $5,000. So the way it works is DEFCON eats the cost of rental insurance and everything, and it actually it was actually a bit of a nightmare because we informed our insurance company we had a dunk tank on the property. They withdrew their insurance, and we had to go find insurance like with 2 weeks to go before the show. They just didn't want the risk. And then so we ate that cost, and we threw in another $500, so it's an even $5,500 if we can have an EFF representative that might be around to take it. Come on up, guys. Receive the dinero. Maybe just say a little bit about the EFF for us, please.
Well, a lot of you probably know EFF is an online civil liberties group. We had a really great DEF CON. Thanks so much to everyone who stopped by the booth. DC702, who organized the summit pre-party, and especially Frank and all the folks who organized the dunk tank. It's absolutely awesome to see everyone support us so much.
I just want to say thank you to everyone who came by the dunk tank this week and helped contribute to the EFF. It was a lot of fun. We have a couple gifts for you. First, we have a staff ball for everyone, all the staff members who are involved in getting the dunk tank up and running and working this week. And here you go. And the second one is, I still need some dunkies to come and find this, but we also have another softball with all the dunkies' names that we want to give to you guys. Thanks a lot, and we really appreciate all the work you do. One last thing I'd like to do is I'd like the guys and the gals who came out and helped me run the dunk tank this year, please stand up and take a round of applause. Thank you very much.
Okay, I'm not sure what the next slide is. We'll see. Oh, yes. Okay, so that pretty much wraps up this year, but I want to remind you that between now and next year's, we want you to guys get involved, and it's never too soon to get involved. For example, Ken Shoto spent many months planning, but it took us several months just to find teams, people qualified who wanted to put on the contest. So if you want to start a contest, you want to do something cool, start planning early and let us know about 5 months before the show. That gives everybody involved enough time to coordinate everything. So think ahead, and here's some stuff to do until the next DEF CON. DEF CON 14, there's going to be some pretty rocking changes. You guys are going to be, it's going to be really exciting for you next year. We're doing some really neat improvements in contest speaking areas. We're going to have more sort of one-on-one learning sessions. We're going to have really a lot of neat stuff going on. I encourage you to participate on the forum.defcon.org. We're always looking for better moderators, more moderators, people, subject matter experts to talk about and teach some of these kids that can't make it here. About what's going on. Not only are we going to be putting this year's DJ action and audio and video online, we're also going to try to solicit from you guys. I really want to pump up our audio video archives. We've got some hacker documentaries on there, but I know more are out there. I just can't have to hunt them down and get permission to put them online. So if you know anybody who's got a cool documentary or some video clips you want hosted, send them on in, and we'll host them on our 10 megabit server. So send in some clips, write up something about DEF CON, your stories, how you vomited on stage at Hacker Jeopardy, you know, blow by blow. And just kind of spread the word. We'd really appreciate that. And then finally, the public over at defconpics.org, they do a tremendous job of trying to be the memory repository for DEF CON. So if you've got some pics, you want to share them, send them on over to the public, and he'll point off to your site. And that's sort of our central go-to jumping off point for a lot of pictures. So with that said, I believe it's time for DT in the pool. I've come to expect this every year, and so this year I've taken off my socks. I've taken off my socks and emptied all the electronics out of my pockets.
Actually, Jeff, this year I can assure you we're not going to throw you in the pool.
Oh.
We have something else
liquid
planned.
Nitrogen?
Gentlemen, ladies, come on down. Zach, would you step up, please? Jeff, you could come on down here to the end.
Uh-huh.
Stand over here on the stage.
Just down the end,
just
seriously?
Down on that end over there.
Okay.
With Zach. Right there. Up on stage, Zach. Goons, come on down. Everyone, goons up in front here. Everybody, come on down. Seriously, we talked about this, folks. We could not do this without Jeff and Zach, or for DT and Zach. We basically would like to salute you, the audience, and Jeff and Zach and everyone else. We, the goons of DEFCON, salute you. That was some very, very, very cold ice water. These guys were panicking about us throwing them in the pool. Several times, both of them, you guys throw me in the pool?
That certainly was cold.
I said, don't worry, Jeff, we're not going to throw you in the pool. Liquid nitrogen. You remember Han Solo from Star Wars?
Okay, with that said, I think we're going to keep the network up for a while till we shut everything down. All the goons are going to take off their shirts. We're going to stop gooning. We're just going to be like you. We're going to cool out, go to the pool, drink some beers, and just, well, maybe take your shirts off. Figuratively take their shirts off. Start the music. So with that, I'd like to thank you all for coming and close DEFCON 13.